Welcome to the Beer and Gear Podcast with Chris Taylor.
Welcome to the podcast, and tonight's guest is the one and only David Falshaw. Dave, good to see you, mate.
And you too. You're looking well.
Oh, dang, it's all filters, mate. It's all filters. Sorry about the scarf. I've literally just come back from the shop and it is cold as balls outside.
So, it is freezing, isn't it? It certainly is freezing, yeah.
It is. So what have you been up to, my friend, during this crazy last year?
Oh, music-wise, I've been doing a bit of recording because I managed to get my hands on, well, first of all, because your good self, you advised me about the Mixcraft software, which I had for my laptop, which is a cracking bit of kit.
It doesn't get spoken about enough, does it? I mean, I think with Mixcraft, it does everything that all the other main ones do that get all the press quietly. Yeah. But if you actually look it up and look at the reviews are all fantastic for it. It's great, you know.
As a simple to use door. You know, it's really up there. You know what I mean? It's up there. But I'll be honest with you. Since I've been able to get hold of some Macs, I've got myself a MacBook Air, and what I'm talking to you on now is just an iMac. I've gone back to Logic.
Oh, right, okay.
Yeah, I've gone back to Logic. So I've been using Logic a bit, and I've just been messing around with things, really. As I managed to get hold of, which is a great, the Superior drummer, which is just phenomenal, absolutely phenomenal. And like I said, all those amps and everything you can get, and the vocal effects, and you know, really, really good. So I've just been messing around with that sort of stuff, really. And to be honest with you, I'm just going to grab it. I managed to get this really cheap.
Ooh.
Jackson 7 string.
Lovely.
It's really cheap, actually. It's really good. I mean, there's a new knob on there. But when you, it's got the dampener as well, because obviously you only want to play the
Groove Gear one, yeah?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, they're great.
When you grab those, you know what I mean? Because obviously it's a standard tune, and then your top string's
it's a low B, isn't it?
This is an A tune.
So it's like a double drop.
It's like a D tuning, but dropped down to an A tuning.
Yeah.
So it's massive. It really is. You know what I mean? And I always fancy just grabbing myself for like a 7-string guitar, because obviously you hear all about this. Is it djembe? Is it called?
Oh, gent.
Djembe is a drum, isn't it? All this gent music, you know what I mean? And it's all like, oh, you know what I mean? And just whatever tune the name must be, because they've got to be lower than an A or something, because it's just.
Yeah, well, you see, a lot of them, because, you know, back, the company I used to work for really was at the forefront of sort of the multi-scale guitars and the extended range. And you know, it went from sevens being sort of the standard, but then dropping down the seventh string from even down to G sort of thing with almost a bass string on it.
Ridiculous, yeah.
And then the eight strings came out, and then you've got a low F sharp, and then they brought the 9 string out, which, you know, I've got 2 7 strings, and yeah. I can adapt to a 7. I do like playing a 7.
Yeah.
I did try an 8 string for a weekend to see if I'd like it, and literally I ended up just taking it. At the time, I could get them at, like, you know, cost price, but I still, it wasn't for me, you know, and it wouldn't cost a lot of money to actually have that guitar, but I didn't connect with it. It was too low, it was too chunky, so I ended up taking it back on the Monday and just going like, you know, it's not for me, but thanks for letting me try it, you know.
You know, it's probably the width of that neck isn't much bigger than a Gibson Les Paul anyway, because, you know, how fat those necks are on a Les Paul.
Yeah.
But Yeah, so I had to go, you know, just bought one of those. It was only cheap, and I thought I'd have a go at that. Like, and it is very hard to get into. It takes your time.
Oh, definitely, yeah.
Takes your time to getting into them. And, do you know what I mean? And
it does if you try, and it's almost like you got to get a different mindset, because you end up playing it as if you're playing normal guitar, and you start playing a few chords, and it's like, whoa, this feels strange. No.
And you end up hitting the E chord. That's not right. You know what I mean?
You're totally hitting the wrong strings, and then but when you do click, it's then you. If you, I always think if you play a 7-string for like 2 or 3 weeks, and you go back to a 6-string, the neck feels tiny. But I do like playing them. It's just I think what people don't understand with the 7 sometimes it's like when they might have a sound that they really like that they used to with a 6-string, and they plug a 7 in and suddenly expect it to sound the same but bigger. But they're not computing the fact that most guitar amps aren't really made to take that low B or low A without sounding woolly. And the trick to really get those real heavy tones is always to put an overdrive pedal or an EQ in front of the amp to basically adjust the EQ for it to hit the amp, and then you can get the really, really big tones. It's making it adapt with that low frequency. But a lot of you'll find that a lot of the genty players, a lot of them don't use amps anyway. They prefer to do it all in the box or with a plug-in or with a modelling device.
It's a lot of them's modelling, isn't it? I mean, because you look at, I mean, one of my first experiences of, so like 7 strings, they probably go even lower, was Meshuggah.
Yeah.
Well, their style. You know what I mean? And
yeah.
I mean, but obviously, I remember going to see them up in Manchester, and they don't use any amps on stage, do they? It's all modelling.
I think I've heard they've started to try and put some more analog gear into their live sets before COVID hit. They were trying a few things out.
Oh, right,
But yeah, you're right. It was the Pod XT units at one point they were using, because that's the only thing that was the sort of pro rack modeling that was out there. Now we're spoilt for choice, but yeah, it's all that really high gain, heavily, heavily gated sound. You know,
massively gated.
That's where the gent comes from, because it goes gent and stops. That's it. Gent. Now you know like me, if you like playing through sort of like normal classic amps, you won't get away with that much gain.
Because
chug, whistle, you know, it's like,
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, I remember playing with a guy once over Birmingham way, 7-string guitar player. And, you know, some great ideas, but as I said, you know, before he put his noise gate, actually switched it on, you know, he was playing through a, what was he playing through now? Could have been a PV. I think the thing, some of the one,
51,
51,
50 or 65.
Something like that, and, you know, and all it was, you know, hiss and feedback. Do you know what I mean? Until he pops the noise gates on, and the noise gates so bloody high as well. You know what I mean? Because he's got.
Yeah, I mean, some of them are using two. They're using one before.
Two noise gates.
They're actually plugging into a noise gate before it even hits the amp. Now, to me, that's just crazy, because it's like you're getting your signal from your lovely pickups on your guitar, and you're squishing the hell out of them before it even hits the amp.
Before it hits the amp, and then squishing it again.
And then you're putting one in the effects loop as well to stop the hiss. So you're basically quieting your guitar signal down before it even gets there. So what's the point of spending hundreds and hundreds of pounds on these amazing pickups that you're going to squish? I've never understood that. And now, back when I use like full tube amps, I do have a noise gate in my pedal board. But what it is, it's an MXR smart gate, and literally all it does, it sits in the effects loop, and it's literally on barely nothing. And all that's to do is to take away the sort of valve hiss, because I play with a lot of gain with a 5150 and things like that. When I stop playing in between songs, it just cuts it off. It's on so subtle, it's unreal. It doesn't stop feedback or anything like that, because I like that kind of stuff.
I want that.
I don't like any gate when it cuts the note. You know, it's like you can hold a note and you can hear the gate. I don't want to hear the gate. I just want it on barely nothing, Just takes away that sort of, or any, it also works for any power. And we've all played in venues where the power's a bit iffy, and you plug your riff in, and you plug your rig in, and suddenly you can hear that strange hum or buzz that's never there before. It'll take that away. But it's only on very, very subtly. You know, I'm not a massive fan of heavily gated sounds, because, like I said, if I want a note to ring out, I want it to ring out. I don't want it to ring out for 4 seconds and then cut off. You know, it's not for me.
I don't know if this is going to work, but I've got this. I'm going to try and play it. No, I don't think it's going to work, unfortunately. I was just trying to see if I could play this audio. Let's have a look at system settings. Apply that. So, it's just some recording I've done with this. With this thing, I just don't know if it's going to go to play or not. Let's see if we can just try it.
I can hear it.
You can hear it.
Yeah.
No, then that's the case. That's the wrong one. So that's the drums. What are we after here then? So I just some of the recordings of I've got here. Let's try. So, as you can see, it's quite So as you can imagine, it's good fun.
Do you know what I like about that, though?
What's that?
It's like, you're playing the 7-string on it, but you're not going for a massively gainy sound. You can still hear the strings. You can hear the notes.
You can hear the string. You're not getting this massive low end of you know, a lot of it you hear. It's not even a note. There's no note there. All you're hearing is a pattern that's being played. And you might as well just have like a piece of big thick wire stretched. Put a microphone to it. Put it through an amp with so much distortion and bloody and everything through it, and just go that.
Boom, boom, correct. Boom, 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 correct. Boom, boom, boom. You can hear the string separation. It goes on to, you know, a lot of people do use too much gain, and I use a lot of gain, but I use light strings and I pick light, so it kind of,
yeah.
It's I'm not just hammering it with 11s on and really making it move air, really. So it almost it can be what some people would say is a metal sound, but it's not, because there's loads of mids in it, and it's always been more of an air of the classic rock sound than metal. So that works for me. So
I mean, right on the other end of the spectrum, for me, the best guitar sound, is a guitar plugged straight into a 50-watt Marshall head and driven, and all you do. Because let's be honest, look at the masters of that, you know, AC/DC. He's had his all his heads have been modded and everything, and I've got a story. I don't know if you've heard about. They were in the studio, and I can't remember what album they were going to record. Anyway, they started playing, and Angus just couldn't get his guitar sound. It's like stumped. I don't know. They tried everything, different amps, all sorts of stuff, and they couldn't get a sound. And he was like, "What is the problem here?" Well, I don't know. So what's any difference? What's the difference you got from live here? I said, "Well, my wireless system." I was like, "Okay, all right." So they plugged his wireless system in. There it was. There was his sound. All because of this wireless system he was using.
I've heard that. That was in the recording of Back in Black. And I think the deal was that wireless just added a little bit of extra push to the preamp. So it just woke it up. It was almost like having, not as much as an overdrive pedal. Let's just say an overdrive pedal on zero gain, just to give that first tune.
Just give it a little push.
Yeah.
So what he'd done, he got it developed. I think they developed it into a pedal. Managed to develop it into a pedal. And then obviously, with Angus and the way he uses his with his wireless, he kept that. But apparently, that's what I heard. They they developed the pedal version of the which was it's more like it said something about slightly compressing the sound. It was compressing the sound at source, and then when it was sent to the receiver, the sound, you know, the signal was sort of boosted again.
Yeah.
And of course, that's just going straight into his into the Marshall amp. You know, it's just incredible. You know,
there's a great rig rundown. I watched a lot of those on Premier Guitar's page, and there's the one with the AC/DC rig, and literally it's just like the guy's like, well, here's the eight heads, they're all on. And he goes straight in. He doesn't have any pedals. He tried a wah-wah once and stubbed his toe on it. That was literally it, you know.
Yeah, it's all volume control. And it's all volume control. When his lead, he just pops his volume.
It goes, they basically said he runs his DSG on 8, and then when he plays a solo, it's on 10. It's just that. Yeah. It's just that, you know.
Yeah, you know, for Malcolm Young, you know, he famous for using that Gretsch guitar. I can't remember which model it was.
It was a duo jet, but he took
something like a jet.
Net pickups out of it, and everything's unwired apart from the volume knob.
Volume pedal.
He's getting full signal from the one humbucker with no crap in between. It's straight to the volume knob.
To the volume knob, straight to a Marshall. Wind it up. Let those valves buzz and distort.
It's a big part of guitar tone. I mean, obviously I've worked in the amp industry for years, but it's amazing how many people don't understand how much the power section of an amp actually gives you tone. I mean, that's where the chunk comes from. It's those power tubes warming up. It's no good having your preamp on 10 and sounding really gainy and having your volume on 1 in your bedroom, because that's going to get lost. You know, you're better off backing your gain off and getting the power amp distortion up so it reacts properly, and then using your resonance and your presence to you know, dial your top and
wind it up. Get those, because that's as I said, that's where your valve comes from. You're winding the amp up and getting those valves nice and hot and under distortion.
Correct. It's like the old, the classic stories about my hero, like Eddie Van Halen, you know, back in the day, it was like, okay, well, we've got a 100-watt Plexi Marshall that only really has any gain, and when you've dimed all the controls, but it's too loud to play in a club, so you have to think of a way to do around it. So he turned everything on 10, then got a Variac light dimmer to adjust the voltage going to the amp. So when he turned it down, it worked harder. It was easier on the tubes, but it got more saturation.
And it's
genius. And now you see that built into amps everywhere. You've got your power attenuator, you can turn your wattage down, blah, 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 blah. But that was done in those days out of necessity, because the gear wasn't around that actually did that. You couldn't get that much distortion that was needed out of the amp without extra pedals. And if you can't afford the pedals...
this is it. What do you do? You know, I remember, listening to... what was it? It was Van Halen, the first album. Running with the Devils, the first track on the album. And then, when you listen to that guitar sound,
completely different to what had been before. It was like,
it was like, hello there, what's going on? The distortion he was getting out of it, and was just phenomenal.
But you can still hear every note. On that riff, for example, he's like playing the middle three strings. There's no root. It's just the middle three strings, and. It's the G, B, and the D string, but it sounds, you can hear every single note in that triad, and it's just, it's a sound that many people have been trying to chase over the years, but, it's of its time, I don't think he set out at the time to go like, well, I'm going to make the, it was just his sound. That's what he figured out.
I like that sound. That's good. And it probably happened by accident.
Yeah, probably.
It probably happened by accident. Generally messing about, it hit something. Oh God, flipping it! That sounds quite nice.
Just a load of trial and error, and having that sort of mindset where you like what you like, and you'll get there somehow. You'll figure a way out to make that sound, and that's with what you've got.
Absolutely.
I think we're blessed nowadays. There's too much gear about. There's too much stuff.
There is too much.
I mean, my Facebook feed every day is like, oh, try this. Oh, here's a free software amp that you can just have if you sign up to our newsletter. I'm like, when's enough? You know what I mean? It's like, I love the 9-6 Helix stuff. It's great. you know, I use that for everything. I mean, back in the day when we could do gigs and stuff, for the backing track gigs, it's amazing because literally you're just going through the PA with the backing track. You can get your tone at whatever level, but if you're gigging with an amp, it's got a whole new life because it can be your pedal board or your channel switcher. It can control your whole rig, and that's what I love about it. Just the fact that that I haven't found something it can't be useful for yet. If you get me,
I get you. I mean that sort of technology is great, but I understand now. You know, they all talk about these. You know, plugins are great. You know, plugins are great, and especially now when you look at the situations where you can choose between like something stupid, 100 mics, you know what I mean? 100 different mics and 100 different positions to put those mics on the cone, different speakers, different amps. And it's, you know, and I just think what's wrong with the old days of just putting an amp in a nice sounding room, turn it up. Do you know what I mean? Move the mic around a little bit. Yeah, that's good. Do you know what I mean?
No, I agree.
I always go back. I just do. I always go back to AC/DC and the simplicity of their sound. You know, and that's. I don't know. There's probably reports out there how they recorded the guitar in there, but I bet most of that was like maybe a close mic up to one of the cones, and then maybe a microphone slightly in the room just to catch the ambience of the amp.
I think so. I mean, if you listen to probably up there with my favourite AC/DC albums, Power Rage. I love Power Rage, but if you isolate the guitar sound on that, literally it sounds like the guy has overcooked it and literally put the mic too close to the cone, and it's that brittle, but it just works. But it literally sounds to me. I mean, don't strike me down for this, but it almost sounds like the engineer was on his first day and just went, that'll do.
Yeah, that'll do.
Put it and right on it because it's so in your face and it's so almost the fact now that if me and you tried to record and got that tone, we'd back the mic off a little bit. You know, we'd move it to the side. You know, slightly.
Yeah,
you know?
Absolutely. But you know, could go on.
I think with me, it's like having all those options. Like, you know, through lockdown, I've literally just got back into songwriting and creating and just doing remote recording all the time. And having the option that I can to record direct signal, and I can forever faff about with the guitar sound afterwards, right?
Yeah.
I actually don't, because it keeps my workflow quick. I'll find the sound that I like. I'll treat it very much as if I was micing an amp in a room, and then once that's done, it's printed. So if you get it right, you get it right. Yeah. I'd rather do that than sit there mixing for 4 months, going, "Oh yeah, but if I just change that to a JMP instead of a Plexi, and I do, oh, it might sound better in the mix." No, to me, it's like, there's the guitar sound. Does it sound good? Print it. And that's it.
You could spend forever, couldn't you, thinking, that's what I do, freaking guitar sound, you know, and think, well, what am I after? You know, like that seven string, I'm after quite a heavy, heavy distorted sound. So I just flick through that's the one, that'll do, thank you very much. And that's it, you know what I mean? Especially when it comes to the writing purpose. I mean, obviously, you know yourself, a sound can be a... It can trigger something. Do you know what I mean?
I think what you're getting at is like so many. If you can find a sound that's inspiring, and you're right.
That's the word. Inspiring.
You'll create something using that thing.
Using that sound. Yeah. Just the sound. Thinking, oh, that sounds great. You know, and then you play a riff or play something. And it's like, you know, and it works well in that way. But I think the crunch of it. Is, you know, it's these things. That's where the talent lies. These things are up here. You can have all the gear in the world. You know, all the gear in the world. But if you haven't got it in the fingers, do you know what I mean?
That's where everyone's tone comes from. You know, there's so many myths, and there's so many. You know, you get told, oh, you need heavier strings to get better tone. You need this. You need that. Billy Gibbons plays with eights. You know. Yeah. Tony Iommi used eights and sevens and things like that, and tuned them down, but still managed to get great tones.
And apparently all his guitars are hollow as well. He has them custom built in a hollow.
This is going to sound like me claiming to fame on this one, but like, I used to have to test his rig. When they were making the signature amps, and what they'd bring in, he'd come in with his tech after the factory closed, and like the whole 8 stacks were all set up because they're all on. That's the way he ran. Really? It was old school. Yeah, and he has in his monitor wedges, right? He has vintage 30s in them, so literally has guitar speakers in the monitor wedges, and he literally has everything on behind him blasting that way, and coming at him from the front, he's got his guitar fed into guitar speakers in monitors. So literally, it's just like. I mean, you can find footage of Sabbath playing towards the end, and you see Ozzy sort of trying to get the crowd going. As soon as he walks near those rows of amps, he literally goes, "Whoa, nope," goes back because it's too loud. But they used to basically bring through. We'd have his one of the JD or the Gibson SGs with him. All his ears are left-handed, so he'd play through the amps to see if it was getting to where he wanted it. His pedal board was all mounted up, basically the whole rig. I'll send you a photo later of me with the rig and everything. They bring in Billy Gibbons guitars are hot hollow, and with the Iommi stuff, like they'd bring in a signature Gibson, his model with exactly the same spec and pickups, but a right-handed model, so then I could play through the rig playing Sabbath riffs, and like literally I've got the main designer and stuff and Iommi like 20 yards away listening to this rig being blasted because it's a reference, because he needs to hear it too, being played what the crowd's going to hear, like. And once this happened, it was a Friday evening, and I'm playing, I'm giving it some Sweet Leaf and all that, and just playing my favourite bits out of War Pigs, which is never the main riff, it's always the because you can really, really hear how the amps reacting with that particular riff. And I'm looking, and like everyone except Iommi's got big like ear defenders on, almost like this, but like and I'm not. And I'm like, oh. So anyway, we finish up and it's great. So I get in the car and I start driving back and put the radio on. Can't hear anything. So I turn it up like more. I'm like, no. It took me till Sunday from the hearing to come back because it was that loud. It was more of a pressure feeling where I couldn't figure out how loud it actually was. It just felt... dangerous.
That's what's all about feeling, isn't it? You know what I mean? I think that's a lot of things that the guys who use modeling amps and don't have actually have amps on stage. Do you know what I mean? I think that's what they're missing. Do you know what I mean? Because
it's got to move air. You know, it depends on the kind of gig. You know, I have done. Obviously, I do a lot of. Used to do a lot of direct gigs where I'm just going into the mixer through the PA. I've also done like gigs at like the Haygate and stuff where I've literally, for a testing purpose, I've turned up with the full band and just the Helix and ran it through the PA. And as long as your monitor mixes right, which it generally was there because they knew what they were doing. And if you told, basically, I'm quite simple. I'll just give them, there's 2 XLRs. I've done the rest. If you want to do anything EQ wise, you probably won't. But just fire it back through this foldback. That would be great. Yeah. And also fire it back through the drum wedge. So the fact that Phil likes a really loud sort of drum wedge with the guitar sound, that was hitting me as well. So it really felt like I had got. I mean, it was weird. I'll be turning around towards my amp that normally was there to get some feedback, and there's nothing behind me. Okay. But for generally for a band gig, you know, I like to have some there. I like to hit that and just.
Yeah.
Make the trousers flat.
I mean, talking about having that feeling behind it, right? When we recorded, do you remember the Space City Cowboys stuff? Do you ever remember that?
I heard of it. Yeah,
you can catch it on Spotify. People go to Spotify and just tap in Space City Cowboys. It's on there. Planeto Cactus Shakedown or something like that.
Well, what I'll do is I'll put the links in the description for the video as well, so anyone
we can have this. Yeah, basically, the guy turned up, lovely chap, great guitar player. Now he was playing through a a Gretsch. It's like a Gretsch Nashville, you know, the Norse Gretsch Nashville with the Bigsby on and everything.
Yeah.
I was playing through that and a mattress.
Beautiful. You
know, yeah, exactly. We all know what mattress, you know what I mean? And they, and you know, they run, I think they run at a 30 watt or 15 watt. Mm. And he turned up and he had all these pedals and everything. And he started, we started playing, having just, you know, see what I can come up with, like, and you know, I mean, we all sat down thinking something's not right here. Something's not right. I don't know. So I said, take your lead out from your effects. Just pop it straight in the amp. So, okay. Popped it straight in the amp. I said, just pop it to 15. Turn it up. Really wind it up like you did. Played the sound. It was like, and there it is. Do you know what I mean? Mm. And there was the sound. There was the sound. And then during the recording and some of the gigs we'd done with the Space City Cowboys, you know, and that was, I think he had a boost pedal for leads, and then a delay pedal, I think, and I think he had just a little bit of reverb on the amp, you know, but that was it. That's all he used, and it was just...
It's the purest ones, the best. It's like... I've done sound at little festivals that I used to put on and things like that, charity ones and that, and literally had a guy turn up with all the rack gear and loads of extra sound. It was an amazing rig, like, but yeah. Once it went through the system, it was like they were trying to find where the guitar sound was, because it was all reverb and chorus and all that kind of stuff. It was like, it's in there somewhere.
It's among all that reverb.
And it probably sounded amazing in a set of in-ears to the guy on stage, but it was like, right, we need, where's the tone gone, you know?
Yeah, there was nothing.
It's like you could see it on the meter, but couldn't hear it. It's like,
couldn't hear nothing. Yeah, where's the actual guitar sound? You know what I mean? Where's the sound guitar and amp? Apart from all, where's all, everything effects, where's all your, you know? Oh yeah, I've known it. Yeah, I played with a few.
My little trick was always like, especially, mostly I'm in bands with one guitar, so I've got to fill a bit of space. Now, my trick always was to get a big, huge guitar sound that spread a little bit. Was always really subtle. I'd always set up a delay, a stereo delay that was always on.
Yeah.
But it's at 12-15% mix. So, you know, when I'm playing, you can't really hear.
Very slight.
Yeah, and I'd set the one side at 800 and the other side at 400. And literally, so if I stopped and did that, it would literally go ch-ch-ch-ch-ch, and that was it.
Yeah.
But when you're playing them big chords and those signals mixed together in a short and a longer one as well, it just does the fill the room thing, you know?
Yeah.
And sometimes even there'd be a little stereo chorus on, and literally it would be on hardly anything. So yeah. you couldn't really tell that there was a chorus there, but it just gave enough shift to spread the sound out a little bit, you know.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. That was my thing really with that. Yeah. Oh God, I miss gigging, man. I really miss gigging.
It's awful. You know what I mean? As I said, most, you know, nowadays I'm mainly, you know, I'm just singing really. Yeah, just now, like on either on a Friday or Saturday night, you know, 7 o'clock, 7:30, you know, or this sort of time, nearly 7 o'clock. You're thinking, well, I better start getting stuff, you know, getting my stuff ready now. And whether it's you know, a little pub where you're playing in front of, I don't know, 20, 30 people. Do you know what I mean? Or you're playing somewhere where there's quite a few more people. It's just. Getting out and just, okay, we're not actually being creative as such, you know what I mean? Because we are already sort of like playing cover songs and stuff like that, but we are creating an atmosphere. That's all we can do as sort of like pub and club entertainers is really, it's just create the right atmosphere, you know, and I don't know a lot about you, but my buzz is when I entertain and sing is the reaction of the people watching. Mm. Yeah. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Totally.
you know, it's watching everybody having a great time, watching people smiling and having fun, and the way I do it anyway, I'm always constantly taking the mickey out of people, taking the mickey out of people. You know what I mean? Obviously, you know, you do to a degree, but you know, if you've got that interaction with people, you know, you're having that, you're not sort of, it's not us and them, you know. The one guy, I remember going to see Elbow in Birmingham, and there's one guy, Guy Garvey, when he talks to you, it's like he's talking to you, do you know what I mean? It's like he's in your sitting room and he's just having a chat with you. The guy is amazing. It makes it so personal with his gigs. The guy's just, you know, phenomenal. You know, and that's for me, that's a sign of a good front man. You know, everyone goes on about Freddie Mercury. Yeah, brilliant. You know, for a stadium. Mm. You know, to have control of a whole stadium in the hand and just be able to do that.
Yeah.
You know, control 50,000-60,000 people like that. You know, it was amazing. But for someone who can make you feel at home, make you feel you're at home, and he knows you personally. You know.
Yeah.
Guy Garvey was just. Yeah.
That's a special skill, that.
Oh, it is. It's incredible. It's an incredible skill. I mean, you know yourself, you know, seeing vocalists which you just stand there in absolute awe of, you know, and just mouth wide open and just incredible. But then they're lacking in other skills as well. Do you know what I mean?
And, yeah, it's having the package. And I mentioned like this kind of thing based on it, one of the podcasts I did last week. It was my ethos on all this, and wherever you're playing, whether it's a pub and no matter who's there, or whether it's a festival, or you know, the biggest one I've ever done was like 3,500 people. You know, but it's the same amount of effort, same show. So to me, I always say, well, see, 4 people or 400, they're getting the same thing. I want those people to enjoy it. I want to feel like they've seen a show.
Yeah.
I never want to be, and I've seen a lot of it, and I did mention this in the other podcast. I never want to be, and I'm sure you've seen them too, one of those entertainers or bands that turns up on a particular night where, you know, it might not be busy, but that might not be the venue or your fault. It might be just there's a massive birthday party for someone in that town and everyone's invited and it wasn't communicated. So they treat it as a free practice, you know,
and they get
a paid practice and they get boring with it and they make comments about, oh, you know, and it's all down and here's another song and I really would rather not be here. That doesn't wash with me. You're getting paid to do a job. Your job is to entertain and perform, and that's what you're there for.
I mean, let's be honest. Yeah, we have all had times where we've turned up to gigs like, oh, that's not feeling it tonight. You know what I mean? We've been doing it. We've all done it.
Yeah.
You know. Do you know what I mean? But for me, I'd like to think that's a real minority of times, extremely small minority of times. Do you know? You've got to put your game face on.
Yeah,
you have to flip
that switch, don't you? You know,
you're entertaining people. You've got to be able to go out and entertain. Forget all that. The reason you're doing this is because you enjoy it. You know, the minute you stop enjoying it, then stop doing it.
So what do you enjoy doing most then? Because we haven't mentioned this yet, but you're like a multi instrumentalist, aren't you?
What do I like doing most?
You play drums in band. I mean, you could even say like some of the acts that you've been in over the years. You know, it's diverse.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, I mean, let me go back. I mean, the first band I was in when I was 14, a band called Wolf, a local band, and I was the guitar player. And then the guy said, we need someone to play keyboards. Dave, you're playing keyboards. Oh, okay. So I had guitar and I played keyboards. And then that sort of band disbanded and then we formed another band. We only want one guitar player, but we're doing a permanent keyboard player. Oh, you can play keyboards, can't you? Oh, okay. So I'm just me playing bloody keyboards, and then that finished. There's a band called Bigfoot, years ago. And then that finished, and then we went on to form Blazing Row, which was more of a rocky blues country band. We need a drummer. Oh, go on, fast, jump on the drums. So again, that's the first instrument I started playing. So I jumped on the drums, you know, and we had some marginal success from that. Played, you know, we recorded a session for the Paul Jones Blues Show on Radio 2. Mm. Played up the Cohen Blues Festival, it's one of the big blues festivals in Europe. Played there twice with Blazing Rail. And then that split up, and then I went on and joined on the drums a, you could call it a bit of a jive band, really. It's the term's called Jump Blues. The guys like Louis Prima and all these sort of guys. And I played with a really great bass player, double bass, who played the double bass. And that was really fun. Recorded a few albums doing that. Played around Europe a lot with that. And that was good fun. That was really good fun with that. But then things fell apart for a bit. And then after that, we formed a band, the Space City Cowboys, which we were on about. Yeah. There was three of us, just a bass player, singer, me backing vocals, and then and then guitar player. And that was good. And we recorded an album, really, you know, probably one of my proudest achievements, being part in the development and the writing and, you know, and the production of that album. That was really enjoyable, that. And then from there, we really went on to onto singing and to being a frontman, because we I sang in a duo again, only, you know, pubs and clubs, but I thought we completely changed them. We went to sing, I was singing soul, all of, you know, soul and Motown stuff.
Yeah.
You know, which was good fun, you know. I made a living from it for like 10, 11 years, you know, a good living from it as well. But then due to circumstances, I moved to Hong Kong for 4 months, and I was gigging out there for 4 months. With the plan, I was going to stop out there and live out there, but due to circumstances like work visas and everything, it didn't happen. So I came back, and I'd done a little bit of. I forgot about that. Yeah, of course, I played in the Foo Fighters tribute, didn't I? Forgot about that. Fat Fighters.
Brilliant.
And that was, you know, and to be honest, they were a very good band. They were really, really good. You know, listening to them and stuff like that, and that was really, really good, but. Then that didn't last long. But when I came back from Hong Kong, I sang solo for a bit, and then it was like, oh, I'm not doing this. I'm not enjoying this. So I packed it in, and I got a gig performing with a classic rock band, Cindy, and I loved it. I absolutely got to going back to my roots, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I saw the video. It was
back to my rock roots, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I left that band due to a clash of personalities, so we say. I won't say any more than that. And I'm with a band now, great bunch of guys, guitar player, a guy called Andy Jones. Bloody good guitar player, you know. And he hardly uses anything. He plays through a small orange amp, maybe it's about 30 watt orange amp. He plays a Charvel. But this guy's good. He's a shredder. Yeah. You know what I mean? Yeah, he's really good.
Yeah.
He's a great guitar player, Andy, and I love playing with him, having the crack. And they're just a good bunch, you know. And but that seems like years away. It's just like, you know.
Yeah.
I think we may have done a gig in January last year.
Yeah.
Two maybe. And then of course, all this COVID stuff happened.
I mean, we I always remember this. We literally had the weekend of the first lockdown. Boris did the announcement when my Bon Jovi dive singer was actually on the way over from Kidderminster to Highley to pick me and the gear up to go. We've got three gigs that weekend.
Oh.
And literally, as he got there, I was like, have you just watched the announcement? He's like, what? I said, well, pubs are shutting tonight.
Yeah, that's it.
I said, so we've got a decision to make now. We need to contact the venue, because I don't really want to drive for an hour to get there and then say, well, we're not going to do it.
We're not opening now. No, of course.
So we give them the option, you know, and they thanked us for that. They said, well, we don't think we're going to get anybody coming now because of that announcement. I think we're not going to get a big rush of people trying to get one last pint in the pub.
Yeah.
They're literally going to go, oh, well, you know, whatever. So,
that was it.
And that was March, you know. And then, like I said, we had 120 gigs booked last year. Yeah. And, and it's crazy, man. We had that period in the summer where it was like, okay, well, you can do outdoor if you pass all the risk assessments and you do this and you do that. And from the other side of it, you know, because I was, you know, booking for a venue at the time.
Yeah.
I thought, well, I want to do this properly because I don't want to get in any trouble. I don't want no fine for it being wrong, you know. Yeah. And I literally rang the council and they hadn't got a clue.
No.
So I was like, well, this is actually not worth the hassle because they could tell me it's okay over the phone.
Yeah.
I'll put an outside gig in, on. Someone complains, the police come and I get a fine. It's not. Yeah.
You know, so, there was no real specific stipulations. You know, I think there are now. I suppose I was lucky enough, I managed to do maybe two or three gigs in the summer, getting towards end of August last year, outdoor gigs. But they'd done it properly. That they had all the tables separated, everyone had to leave their name and everything, blah, 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 blah. Yeah. I may have done in total, three solo gigs and then two gigs with the band, and that was it.
Well, the only thing we did after March was a last minute, it was actually an all day socially distanced, and it was done really, really well. It was Halloween. It was a Halloween disco and cabaret thing, and literally me and Carl got booked but the day before, and it was perfect. It was a big working men's club with everything spread out completely, but...
Yeah, yeah.
The weirdest thing doing, like, it was the kids' disco from 2 till 6 with all the games, so it was socially distanced past the parcel. So you're talking about it. Don't get me wrong, it was handled brilliantly. How is this going to work?
Clean it, pass it on.
It was literally like musical chairs, but tell you what, I'm glad I weren't playing it. Because these kids must have ran a marathon, you know, trying to get it.
Passing it over to monster.
But also at this thing, it was like we're doing a disco all day to a load of people sat down that can't dance, and you've got to try and gauge that feedback. They're like, what?
Oh, it's awful.
And plus, it's got to be at a low enough level because obviously the decibel level for the, you know, don't want people to shout and sing along. It was so weird. And I actually felt like I feel kind of bad because I feel like they could have just put the radio on, really. On
you know what I mean? Sometimes it's like, well, it's not, you know. It's. It felt like this isn't worth it.
But they really liked it because of course we got like Carl being the sort of mouthpiece and getting everyone involved in a nice way and being the banter. That's what was missed. And that made me think. Do you know what? They're not here for the music that's playing. They're here to. There's something happening. There's just something happening. You know, and it was. That's the only thing that we did. I mean, we have. I mean, got a. With the full tribute band, we've actually got a gig that's actually still advertised at the moment. And I think Starport Civic Hall are being either very ambitious or very hopeful. But we're booked for the 30th of April.
Really? Now,
yeah. And I'm like, well, I can't really see that happening. But then again, those gigs are probably the safest ones because they're the kind of big places where they can limit their capacity and say, well, okay, one in every four seats, someone can bring one, you know. I don't know. It's not been cancelled yet. It's still.
I'll be honest with you. I don't. I'll be very surprised if we're not back to any kind of normality getting on towards Christmas time, end of the year.
Me too. My gut feel is around a sort of October time. They'll be like, okay, well, we can do this.
But... Yeah. Hopefully, everybody would have been, you know, being vaccinated by then, or whatever. But.
And the ones that don't want to be vaccinated won't be allowed in. I'm guessing that's the way it's going to work.
Well, that's what they're talking about, aren't they? They're talking about kind of like an ID card, aren't they? Where you've got to show that you've been vaccinated. You know what I mean? And so, although it's not something really doing that sort of thing really wouldn't really work, I don't think, because it's not right. But, I had COVID. I had COVID a few weeks back.
Yeah, you did.
Me and my girlfriend had COVID, you know.
Lucy's dad had it.
Did he?
Knocked him about a lot. Yeah.
Well, I'll be honest with you, it didn't... What it done for me, it was... tiring. Just made me feel very tired. Very, very tired. And I had a bit of a sniffly nose, really. But the worst thing for me was my taste and my smell.
Mm.
It still hasn't come back. It still hasn't come back properly. No, my taste and my smell still hasn't come back. And that's the worst thing about it, to be honest with you. It really is. So we were, and then obviously the worry about anyone else we've been in contact with, and you know, but to sort of going back to the music thing, you know, it's killing it. It's killing it. You know what I mean? You got anything down from your little pubs that were putting solo acts on, and you know, and stuff like that. To venues which are proper music venues, say like the Robin or I think it's called the Running Horse in Nottingham, and all these sort of places, you know, these medium-sized places. And again, all the way up to the providers, you know, PA and lighting and rigging and trucking and accounting, you know what I mean? All this sort of stuff, all the backroom stuff that a lot of people
don't think of it.
All they see is, you see this big stage with lights, you know, they'll see the roadies on the stage sweeping up or getting everything ready, you know, the guys mixing sound and doing the lights, and then the band come on, do their stuff, and then once that finished they're all gone. But they don't realize the thousands of people who are dependent on British live music industry.
It's massive. You look at it and it's all right. It's the industry in terms of size isn't very massive, but the people that are involved do so many different jobs on that.
And also too, the financial benefits of the, you know, it's a multi-billion pound thing. Do you know what I mean? And that's just in the UK.
Yeah.
That's just in the UK. Do you know what I mean? You know, I'd reading in the news about something to do with, they were talking that, you know, for touring bands and everything, maybe having to look at permits or, do you know what I mean? Or stuff like that.
Yeah, well, I've looked at it for, you know, since the Brexit thing, and that is, you know, the rite of passage, like I say, was, you know, we've got a band, we've got our own songs, let's go and do a European tour, let's get the van packed up, let's take a couple of buddies and let's go and do it. Okay, yeah. Well, if you're willing to fill in different customs forms in every single country and be willing for them to pull out everything that's in your van down to the nearest plectrum,
yeah,
and still make your gig that's booked at 7 o'clock at that club for sound check, because if you don't get there, it ain't happening. You know, it's crazy. Yeah. Now, I've got some guests lined up in the next couple of weeks, which is going to go into this a little bit more for the people that, like we said, a lot of people don't know any of this that goes on. They just buy a ticket and go, oh, wow, that was a great gig, bye. Wasn't the lighting great? I've got some interviews lined up with tour managers.
Brilliant.
And the guys that run the merch for touring bands, and how their day goes and how this is going to be affected by it, because these guys have literally just been sat with I'm in a lot of the forums with the people that put gigs on and events on in the UK, because I used to be involved in the backline for it, for example. I had to deal with the endorsed artists that I got when they flew in or came into the country to do shows and that. So you do get to know a lot of the tour managers, a lot of the techs. Those are the people that you deal with every day. But people that may listen to this wouldn't never have thought about those people. And all those people have been left solely on their asses by a support network that hasn't supported them whatsoever.
What gets me, you know, they talk about, okay, let's be honest, you know, maybe those persons for a temporary could go and work in a shop, work in a factory, just for the period of time while their business. But they're actually looking, trying to get people to retrain to do different jobs. Now, you know, some people have been in the music industry since they started. Since I don't know when they were 16, 17, when they went and helped their mates you know, lift gear in and out the van and doing a few local gigs. You know, and I mean, they've gone on from that, and you know, and to have done every job in you know, in the business when you're talking about on the road, yeah. And there might be a road manager now, or yeah. A stage manager or production manager, you know.
Yeah.
And this is all that guy knows all his life, and he might be 50 odd, and this is all he's done all his life.
Yeah.
He's been you know, at the road,
job,
on the road,
job to job. You know,
doing production for someone, and you know, and all that sort of stuff, and he's been able to. But you know, how do you expect a guy in his 50s to completely retrain to be an IT consultant? Or
it's crazy. I mean, that advert that went out with the ballerina. I mean, it's that got took down really quick. I mean, it got ripped apart by the industry. So literally, like, well, that's really great. You've shown a picture of a ballerina that's been put together by. A graphic designer. That's in the arts. That's had copyright done by a copywriter that's in the arts.
Yeah. Exactly.
You know.
Do you know? And it's, and as I said, but you know, I think, don't get me wrong, short time, over the short period, you know what I mean? You know, you have to do what you've got to do to pay the bills, you know, to make a living.
Yeah.
I get that. Do you know what I mean? But yeah. We're trying to get someone just to completely come out of out of their knowledge range. You know what I mean? Where in their knowledge range of production, they know everything.
Yeah.
They know everything. But you know what I mean? But put him. I don't know. Put him in a factory and tell him, you drive that forklift truck and put that up there. This is going to be your job from now on. You know, it's really. It must be. It's. You know. It's tough, and I think the music industry has been something that hasn't really been helped that much. I mean, the situation when they said, oh, we're going to give X amount of million to the arts. Yeah. Where did all that money go? Where did it all go? It went to your Royal Opera House.
It went to
all your massive big venues. Yeah. What about these smaller venues?
Yeah.
You know?
The ones that rely on the okay, they will get some medium sized acts in there, but they also rely on the midweek gigs where it's the people with the smaller followings and the people that also want to put their own shows on and sell their own tickets and that kind of thing, you know.
That's right. You know what I mean? Because again, you know, they do, well, a lot of the smaller places depend on wet sales, don't they?
Yeah.
You know, yeah. You know, and if they've got, you know, if they've got. See, that's the whole what people don't understand, the whole progression there. We're talking about going to see a band, you know. You go and see a band, what do? You walk in, you may buy a hot dog, yeah?
Mm.
Now, those hot dogs aren't being sold. So if those hot dogs aren't being sold, they're not being bought from your supplier. If your supplier can't, you know what I mean, then you've got that chain going back. You're going to have a beer, yeah? Well, that beer isn't being sold in the venues now. So the supplier has got all his beer to waste, so that's pulls down the drain. So he's making a loss. And it's just, they don't realise the huge knock-on effect going backwards that it's caused. Well, I suppose that's in every business, isn't it, really? But,
yeah.
You know, when I don't know, I just feel as though, you know, even the arts, when we're talking about, maybe not like Royal Ballet, but we're talking something like a local organisation down the road that does street dance for kids, you know what I mean? Who's open, I don't know, maybe just four nights a week, and all they're doing is they're making enough money to pay for the bill, to pay the bills, maybe pay a small fee to the teachers, but they're doing it because the kids need something to do. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And all of this, but those sort of organisations and those sort of places. That's it. They're gone in the water now. They can't afford to. They lost the buildings. The people can't afford to. You know, there's no one to teach. So yeah, the arts. I think the arts are really, really. Apart from when we're talking arts, we're talking like your national
theatre productions and things like that, and all the big
places. You know what I mean? But they're not going to be affected.
I do think though. I'm hopeful of this that you know that when the okay is out there that, you know, that entertainment can come back, that there'll definitely be a sort of demand for it. Because
surge. I think so.
What I saw in the summer, people just being really excited after just 3 months of lockdown to go and watch someone in a pub garden.
Yeah.
You know, and it was the best thing ever. And I wasn't one of the people that benefited from it, but I know a lot of people on the circuit that were doing two or three gigs a week.
Yeah. You look everywhere.
And there was a few people taking the piss as well and uploading their videos of where they were, and there was no guidelines being met or anything. And I was thinking, are you stupid or you know, there was a lot of that going on. There was a lot. I mean, I saw them. I saw videos of people.
With social distancing, where's all that going on?
Well, yeah, I saw videos of people where it was like, you know, playing in a care room.
Yeah.
But they'd moved inside because it was raining a bit. What? You know, it's like, you know. It's like...
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you what, one thing I did like, it's not my thing. I think I might have tried to do it once, but I was like, no, this isn't for me. They were doing like the small online gigs and stuff like that. You know, and that was great. That was really good. Basically, it was a lot of solo singers were doing it, you know. But they were doing it, you know, someone's going to start at 7 and do an hour till 8, and then 8 till 9, 9 to 10, 10 till 11. You know, and that was good, you know. And if people enjoyed going to watch these guys singing and everything, it was good. You know, it was a good entertainment thing, you know.
I spoke about this when I was speaking to Sven Mann, because that there was the big thing at one point, wasn't it? People couldn't gig, so I'll do you a show from my living room and stuff.
Yeah.
And you know, it was, we were all striving for just something to look at, weren't we? You know, because we're all stuck in our houses. And I mentioned it last week. I was like, but I started to feel bad that when people started doing it too often, that if I didn't log on and watch it, that because it tells you who's watching, that they'd feel like I wasn't supporting them, and I didn't. Almost got to a film like, well, it's too much now. There's you've been live 3 times this week, and I really want to watch a film now. I don't want to watch that again. You know, what I mean? It was too much.
It was, for me, the first lockdown, it was great. You know what I mean? Because there were people organising, and you know, and as I said, they were putting it on. And what was nice, it wasn't just like local acts you could see. It was people from all around the country. You know. So I didn't really watch a lot of them, to be honest with you, but you know, a lot of people, you know, people said, oh, have you seen blah blah blah, you know, they were on like the other night and they're watching, they were really good and everything. So that was good, you know. That was a good thing of keeping people's.
Have you seen the group? That's one thing I subscribe to. I don't upload on it, but the Kev, who sings with the sort of the Streets Apart project that does. Isolation Open Mic. I think that's a really brilliant group, that is. And it's literally, it's just people posting videos up from all over the world, and started in the UK, I believe. And they'll do themes each week. So it'll be like movie week. And it's literally just people sat in their house on an acoustic instrument, and there's some people playing orchestral stuff and everything. And it's just them singing, doing a video to their phone of them doing a cover based on what they want to do and just putting it up. Yeah. And that's really cool. But they've also done some really good stuff with it, raising money for charities, you know, and starting. And that's just, you know, it's they're not performing to go, hey, here's my hour-long set, what do you reckon? It's like, I've done this song, what do you think? Here's the link for the charity that we're raising money for. Please give generously, you know. And they all get together. It's cool. That's really good. And there's no prejudice against ability or whatever. It's totally sinners. Nice one, mate. That might be the first time you've ever tried to sing a song on camera. Brilliant.
Yeah.
Keep it up. You know, it's great. It's total bare bones, and it literally is like. That's why it's called isolation open mic, you know, because it's the same as turning up with your guitar to a pub and going, oh, I'll have a go.
Yeah.
But that can be the start of anyone finding their passion in it. Yeah.
Absolutely, of course it is.
You know, a lot of people did start off by getting up on a karaoke drunk and then realising, actually, I can do this. I'll learn. I'll try and learn to sing and properly and have a go at it, you know.
Yeah, but sometimes that can go a bit you know.
Well, well we've seen there is a lot of them, and you know that they'll do two or three songs in a karaoke and try and book themselves a gig. They'll buy a PA and be like, okay, well I can do this now, and I'm a singer, and it's great.
This is the whole thing about all this X Factor and the voice and everything. And it seems, for me, I'm not saying everyone, you know what I mean, but it seems to me, you know, I'm pushing on a bit. Okay, I've had a tiny bit of, you know, I was able to spend a period of time making a living out of music, but not a vast fortune, you know. But, you know, I've, like yourself, I've, you know, what's the word I'm after? I've been on the road, do you know what I mean? Mm. I've slept in the back of bloody vans overnight.
I think what this thing, you've paid your dues.
Well, this is it, you know what I mean? Yeah. I paid my dues, you know, I've played some like rubbish places, you know. Some horrible holes. We travelled miles for nothing, and you know, and done all this other stuff. and I think that's something that's missing with some of the, not all of them. I'm not going to say all of them, but some of the guys who go out being musicians now, you know, they lack that experience. Shall we say that road not weariness, but that. So, let's say the knowledge. Do you know what I mean?
It's like miles on your gigging clock, isn't it? You know, it's
You know, they've got some miles under their belts. You know.
Yeah.
You know, because these guys, they'll go on to, on the X Factor, whatever, and then because they've got. You know, they've got a nice, they look good, and you know, the girls are going to like them, and or the boys are going to like them, and they've, you know, and they've got an okay voice, not great, but it's okay, nothing special, you know, but they go and win the X Factor, and then what happens then, you know, they'll spend time with a vocal coach, they'll have a producer and a songwriter write the songs for them. You know, again, I'm not saying everyone, you know, because there are some really talented people out there who do make it. You know what I mean? And I mean, well, I watched a documentary about a young guy from America, Morantz. Is it something Morantz?
Jason Morantz.
Yeah. What's a documentary about him? You know what I mean? Now, there's a young lad. But he's got the miles under his, you know, from a young age, he was going out gigging and playing his guitar, you know. And there's a talented young man, you know, and he's put the mileage in, he's done the mileage, and he's doing a bit. So, you know, he deserves everything that comes to him. But as I said, I just feel like some of the guys just haven't got that, you know, they you know, someone dresses them, someone does their makeup, someone tells how to act. And, you know, these are the songs you're singing. This is, you know what I mean?
It's the manufactured thing, and I think it's really starting to spread now into also the minefield that is self-promotion and social media. Story, I don't know if you saw the story yesterday about the guitar player. He was a fantastic guitar player. He was literally took down his accounts because he's literally fed up of the rat race of trying to promote himself amongst millions of people putting fake videos up and speeding their playing up or dressing up as an idiot and getting like a million more likes than him when he's actually spent all of his life learning his craft. And it's playing with his mental health. He's got the point where it's affecting him that bad. He's literally taking his accounts off. He's literally, I need to get away from playing guitar. I need to get away from this situation. And it's true, man. I mean, like,
absolutely.
I follow a lot of, guitar centric or gear centric channels on YouTube, you know, and sometimes it freaks me out. There's so much I love, and I love watching things like Rick Beato's channel. I find that amazing, where he'll just go through. I mean, he's got 2 million followers now, and God bless him, because his content is that good. You know, his series on what makes this song great is just amazing. He's done about 90 episodes, but he'll break down. he's got the isolated tracks of stuff we all know and love, and he'll go, well, this is why this song's good, and here's a 15-minute video, and he's literally, here's the drums, check that out, it's not to a click, how good is that, and here's this filthy, they're great, and he'll, but he'll...
Let's pull a link up to that. I wouldn't mind.
Oh, mate, you'll love them. It's really good. And like on the other side of it as well, he'll show his diversity at like. He just loves music. His channel's called Everything Music. So he'll do this thing every 3 months where he'll do, he'll do a video and he'll basically go like, "What I'm going to do is, are we going to listen to the top 10 pop songs on Spotify, right?"
Yeah,
and you're expecting this guy who's in his late 50s, and he does. He's very. He loves his classic rock, and you know. But you're thinking, okay. And he's sat there with his acoustic guitar, and he'll play the first song. This is by so and so, and it's like a rap song or a pop track. And you kind of expect him to be looking at it like, "What's this crap?" But he's not, because he loves music, and he'll literally go, and he'll go 1, 6, 4, okay, and he'll figure out the chord progression.
Yeah,
he'll tell you what he thinks about it, and a lot of the time he's literally going, "Do you know what? It's not my kind of thing, but I love the production. I love that beat.
I love
that bass line on that. The vocal melody is fantastic." And you'll go, you know, and it's just this guy just loves music, and I love watching that kind of channel. Yeah. But on the other hand of it, there's guys that get 4 million subscribers, and basically all they do is make videos. They've got enough money to put perfect cameras and perfect. To computers that do all the video editing, it might as well be a Hollywood movie sort of thing. And that's all paid for by YouTube. And fair play, they've made enough money through sponsorship and all that to be able to...
Advertisements, yeah.
To invest that in their craft, yeah? But a lot of the time, I find the content, it's horrible. They will, for example, there's one guy, I'm not going to get into the YouTube wars, but there's literally one guy that's quite easy to find, but will make a video ridiculing somebody.
Yeah,
I mean, absolutely ripping the piss out of them.
Yeah,
and there's kids that watch his channel, and they're literally going, "Oh, but he said it, so it's funny. It's great."
Yeah.
And
influencers, aren't they?
I don't like it. You know, I mean,
you can go on YouTube and you can find some incredible stuff.
Yeah.
Some amazing stuff. You really can.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? What is the question for you then? This just got me thinking when you were talking about the guy listening to the music. Do you see music?
Do I see it?
Yeah.
What do you mean how I...
If you're listening to a guitar player...
Yeah.
And you're listening to him, can you see what he's playing?
If I'm just hearing it? Can I?
You listen to it in your headphones. You listen away. The guitar player is playing something, like an acoustic, or whatever. Can you see what he's playing?
I guess I can. Because
that's what I do when people say, "Well, how do you?" Because basically, I listen to someone and I can see what they're playing. Do you know what I mean?
I've always been a visual learner more than anything else. Yeah.
I see in my head. That's what I see in my head. If I see a guitar playing, and you know, he might just like, let's have a look at Wonderwall, just for example,
yeah.
And then we all know the chorus of that is E minor, G, D, A, yeah.
The capo, he's got
the capo. You know what I mean? But it's basically that's how most people play it. But he's got the constant G note, hasn't he? Going, you know what I mean? Now, when you listen to that, I see those chords in my head. That's what I do. I see those chords, you know, ding, 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 and I can see a hand on a guitar neck, and I can see those chords being played.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? But it doesn't necessarily have to be that. It could be something completely else. Yeah. And I can hear the progression they're playing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And I can see what they're playing in my head. Do you know what I mean? Cool. So nine times out of ten, I can see that. You know what I mean? And I'll listen. And I can pick a guitar up, and I can go, yeah, it's something like that. It may not be exactly it, but it's something like that. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I suppose that's one of the skills I am good at doing. You know what I mean?
I learned that. Like I said, I can visualize from listening to something how to play it, and then then I can pick it up because I'm a very visual. If I've got to put it this way, one of the ways that YouTube is great for me. Is when I've doing cover gigs. And if I want to, I get told, we're doing this song, can you learn it?
Yeah.
I won't listen, well, I'll listen to it once. And I'll try and play along and I'll get most of it. But I'd rather put a live video on of the guitar player playing it. I'll watch that and I'll go, yeah, okay, cool. And I'll play it without it being on. I'd rather watch a playthrough video and just absorb it for those 4 minutes and then be like,
yeah,
well, I'll pick the guitar up and I'll play it. And I'll be like, good, done. And that leaves me with enough room for improvisation as well, because by then I've figured out what key it keys in. I've figured out which notes are going to work. So I can do that live now. I can get out there and do it, but with my own little spin on the chord voicings and stuff,
yeah.
I want to, you know? So,
yeah.
But it's... It is a fantastic tool, you know. I mean, YouTube is probably the thing that I don't really watch. Well, I don't watch normal TV. I get my news from, if I want to, if you want to really see the news, Sky News is always live feed on YouTube. Just click that on or whatever. I'd rather, it's almost like as I've got older, and especially with lockdown and stuff, I'd rather watch and support the content of someone that's trying to do their own thing than someone that's just been given a job on telly. You know what I mean? I like to watch people creating their own content. You know, there's a lot of them that I'll send you the links to. I think you'll love the Rick Beato channel. I can literally watch that for hours. You know, it's great stuff.
Have you ever watched the classic albums? I mean, they're good.
I love them. He does is quite similar to that. Obviously, he's not got the real people in the room with him because he's doing it in his own studio, but he's literally breaking down the isolated tracks or everything. But also, other things he does, interviews, but he's gained enough followers now where he can actually go out and film, like a couple of months ago, that he's the people know that he gets the views. Because it's all musos like us that are interested in that kind of stuff. It's nerdy stuff. Where he can literally go, well, today's video, I'm sat with Peter Frampton, you know, and things like that. And it's like, well done, man. You've done it the right way. You've actually gained this community by being true to what you actually want to show and what you believe. And the big musicians will listen to that and be on that, won't they? You know what I mean? They'll be like, yeah, cool, I'll go on that channel. If he's got 2 million subscribers, I will gladly sit with him for an hour and talk about my stuff. You know,
Absolutely.
I'll send you all that. Anyway, what I want to get onto actually, which I'm, you know, you're doing a great job at the moment with the marketing of it as well, which I've seen, but you've recently started with your own radio show as well, haven't you?
Oh, yes. It's Dave Falso's Classic Rock Show. Dave Falso's Classic Rock Show. It's at 9 p.m.
Yeah.
On a Friday evening. And it's on, you really only get it on the internet, but there is an app as well for it if you want to listen to it. And it's Seven Bridges Radio. So that's obviously not, it's Seven, S-E-V-E-N, Bridges Radio. Yeah. If you go online, you can put that in, sevenbridgesradio.com, you can go on there. There's all details of the shows that are on there. So I'm on there on a Friday night, 9 till 10.
Mm-hmm.
I just wanted to, you know, something came up about the opportunity to do a show, and I, you know, just my love for classic rock is just, you know, huge, and I love that sort of stuff. So yeah, decided to put a show. I'm playing all that stuff. But what I've started to do as well is start to do featured artists. So I've had some. I've had some guys who sent me some new stuff. There's an old friend of mine who lives in Crete. I think it's Crete now. Brian Meacham. He's got a new album coming out. 2 to 100, I think it's called, something like that. But if you go onto my Facebook page, Dave Falso's Classic Rock Show on Facebook, like that, I put all the links up there to the shows and to the artists. So that was last week. Also, you can go on Mixcloud.
Yeah.
And all my shows are on there. I think you'll find there's a link on my Facebook page for that as well.
I'll add all the links. I mean, if there's anything, we finish this, that any link, ping it over to me and I'll put them all on the description as well.
Yeah. So on this week, I've got a band you probably heard of, Voodoo Sue.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Yeah, got Voodoo Sue. So they're the featured artists this week. Next week, I've got a friend of mine who's doing really well at the moment on the sort of like the blues country rock scene. Troy, a friend of mine called.
Oh yeah, Troy.
Yeah, so he's on Wixer. And hopefully, I'm going to be doing a bit of an interview with. We're going to have to excuse me what his name is. Let me just quickly look on my messages and I shall get his name up. There we go. Come on, Mike Gray. His name is not Mike Gray. Now, right. This guy is very, very good guitar player. His new band's called Shades of Grey and he's got an album coming out. But he's played with a lot of bands.
Is that Mike, Mike? Is that M-Y-K-E? Is that
who's M-Y-K-E.
Playing Skin. I saw him play with Skin in the 90s.
Skin, yeah.
Great player.
Yes, Skin. UFO earlier he's played on. Anyway, so I've got a few tracks from him and I'm going to hopefully do an interview with him in the next couple of weeks. But, yeah, so as I said, you know, you can find me on Facebook. If you like your classic rock, then tune in. They can send like requests of any songs they want to sing. But the main thing is if there's anyone out there who's playing in a band doing the originals of the classic rock genre, then get in on Facebook, get in touch with me, and we'll sort you to get some tracks sent over and possibly do a bit of an interview for the show as well. So
That's brilliant. Yeah. I think it's great. I mean, it's another medium that is well worth looking into for people who want to be creative. You know, that's a perfect fit for you, Dave. You know, classic rock show on a Friday night. It's great. I mean, you are the new Tommy Vance.
There's so many shows out there, but it just gives me the opportunity to play songs that I love at the moment until people start hearing about it and then they'll start sending me requests in and everything.
The great thing is that you're going to introduce a lot of people to stuff they might necessarily have
heard. Yeah, because I'm a lot of the stuff sort of started with that's the new wave of British heavy metal. You know, that's the sort of the stage I was brought up from, you know, Saxon, Iron Maiden and I can't even think off the top of my head now. But these are the bands that I grew up on.
Yeah.
And it's always been there. It's always had like a bit of an undercurrent. All the years. But I reckon since about 2005, 2010, it's been a massive resurgence of the new wave of British heavy metal bands. All got back together. All play. You know, bands like Thunder. You know, they got back together and start playing. A very poppy band, but listening back to them, they really got a band called FM.
Yeah,
Remember FM? You know what I mean? No, actually, they were you know, some really good stuff. So all these bands are getting back, and there's a massive resurgence of the classic of the new wave of British heavy metal.
And you're also seeing it with the sort of, because there was another mini resurgence in the 90s with the UK bands, you know, and I love seeing it, like, you know, Terrorvision doing stuff.
Yeah, exactly.
I'll tell you one thing that I really, really like. Little Angels. Love Little Angels. You see what Toby Jepson does every Thursday?
No.
Well, we're talking about the Facebook Live and that, but literally every Thursday through lockdown, he started it really small, but now he still does it. He does the kitchen busker sessions, and he'll do a gig every Thursday night, and it's great because literally he'll say, "Well, okay, what do you want to hear?" He'll put a poll up, and literally someone will say, "Can you do like the first album all the way through, or can you do Young Gods all the way through?" And he'll go, "Yep, not played these for years, but he'll do like a themed." Yeah, but he'll put a link up raising money for a certain charity or for whatever, and it's cool. It's the kitchen busker sessions he does, and it's cool.
Yeah. Friday night 9 till 10, 7 Bridges Radio, Dave Falsworth's classic rock show, and it's really good because I've had a friend of mine do me a jingle as well. Which is really, really cool. Let me just see if I can find it. I'll just play it quickly out. We'll have to go in a. I'll go in a minute. But where are we? Jingles. So hopefully you'll be able to hear this.
Show.
That's amazing.
So that was something that Brian done, my mate done. So yeah, so it was great. So it's all coming together. Do you know what I mean?
That's great. I got some voiceovers done this week for the podcast, man. I tell you, all the production values going up with each one. I'll tell you why, because every time I do one, this is the third one now. You learn a little bit more and you start changing a little bit more, and yeah. You know.
Yep.
But I got in touch with my old sales manager from Laney, who had the best voice ever. And we used to get him to do the voiceover work on product demonstration videos and that. I mean, he sings in a choir and he's very deep. And I literally got hold of him on Saturday night and sent him a quick message and said, "Will you do me a quick favour?" And he just, "No problem, dear boy," you know. And the next day he sends me like 15 different voiceovers of him doing the top and tails for me, but also different versions of them as well. I mean, some of them are hilarious, you know. I'm going to keep interspersing them, but
that'd be great. Great. I look forward to seeing this on your YouTube channel when it comes out anyway, so.
Yeah, well, I'll put all the links in below for everything that we spoke about as well. You obviously for cross promotion, and I'll, there'll be links in the actual video as well for at the end of it for people to click on whether they want to subscribe or whether they want obviously to follow the radio show. And I think what we should do as well is when we do get some news and when we can go out and do things again, we'll catch up again.
We
could talk about what we've got coming up. If we get to a position where we've got a gig forecast again, it'll be great.
Yeah, if you've got some original stuff written, get them sent over and I'll get them on the show. That's not a problem.
Brilliant, man, because we're putting out song number 28 this week. I'll send you in. There's a few in there that are classic rock style, so that'd be great. We try to do something different all the time, but we're going to release the whole back catalogue on one day on four CDs. Brilliant. At some point.
I look forward to hearing that'll be great.
Yeah, man, well it's been great catching up with you.
And you, mate.
And we'll definitely do it again. I think we've had a bit of everything. We've had the different sides of the industry of the gigging musician and a bit of gear talk today, which is good for the nerds that want to hear about things like that.
That's it.
Obviously no beer in today's chat because you're a cup of tea man.
Well, no, I've started having a few drinkies. I blame my girlfriend. I blame her for that. All right, mate. Listen.
All right, man.
Great talking to you.
You too.
And I'll see you again soon. Cheers,
mate. I'll see you soon, Dave. Thanks so much.
Cheers, guys. Take care. Bye now.
Bye. Bye.
You've been listening to the Beer and Gear podcast with Chris Taylor.